Would you please stand together with us if you're able, and let's sing that.
We bring the sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord. We bring the sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord. And we offer up to you the sacrifices of thanksgiving. And we offer up to you the sacrifices of joy. We bring the sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord. We bring the sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord. And we offer up to you the sacrifices of thanksgiving. And we offer up to you the sacrifices of joy. Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving.
Hearts as we enter in this time of worship and praise and honor to you and hearing your word. Thank you for each one who's here. I pray, Lord, that our hearts would be full of thanksgiving to you today in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated. In 1970, Governor Jimmy Davis asked Dottie Rambo to put lyrics to the tune that you know as Danny Boy. She wanted to write something about the grace of God, but she was a little bit stuck about it. She visited her brother, who was dying with cancer that only had a few weeks to live, and she tried to talk to him about his soul and ask him to repent and give his heart to Jesus. And he said, "I've just done too many things. I've been in jail and I've done drugs and I've spent all this time." And she reminded him about the Lord, who told the story about the man who had 100 sheep and left the 99 to find the one that was lost. Well, she visited him later And on a later visit, he told her, "I've given my life to Jesus," and he got saved. Then she wrote the words of this song to the tune, "Danny Boy."
Thank you, choir. Thank you for joining us today as we worship together. If you have any prayer requests you'd like to share, we have the connection cards you can fill out and just drop those in the offering box on the table with the purple tablecloth. And do thank you to everyone who stayed last week for our children's workers meeting. That was a great success. And thank you to everyone who took part and everyone who helped with the meal and helped clean up. And thank you to everyone who took Halloween tracts and gave away things, gospel witness last night. We had actually more at our house than we had the year before. We had almost 60 people came by. We ran out of tracks. We ran out of candy even. just surprised that we had more. But hopefully the Lord can use the message that we put out there. We just sow the seed and trust Him for the results. We do have some election guides here on the back table with the white tablecloth. Probably many of you have already voted with early voting, but if you're not sure yet, there's election guides there just to give some details on where candidates stand on biblical issues. And then we've got our new Wednesday series coming up on all the Wednesdays of November. So if you've been wondering about polygamy, maybe you're thinking about adding another spouse, maybe you're thinking about Maybe you're thinking about joining the Mormons. I don't know, but you might. Anyways, if you want, a lot of people struggle with like, okay, how these people that love God, it seems like they get a pass for this sin. So that's what we're going to look at all the Wednesdays here in November. We'll look at they actually don't get a pass for it. So we'll examine that. So that's this Wednesday at 7. We also have by the offering box, there's sign up lists for the Family Lord's Supper. So always here at the church, we've done family communion time. So each family signs up for an individual time slot on the Sunday or Monday there. And you just come in with your family and meet and have a more personal communion time is how we do it around Thanksgiving. So the lists are over there. You can pick which time works for you. If we end up filling up all of Sunday and Monday, we can add some more on another day. But we'll just see how many people are interested in doing that. And we'll make sure everything is germ-free and safe. Whoever prepares it will wear gloves, and we're doing a little different. We'll have the communion bread. It's going to be an individual little ketchup cup size thing, so the bread won't touch each other. You won't touch some other family's bread, so we'll keep it all separated there. So thank you for that. The kids can go ahead and be dismissed and head next door to their class, and even more candy for them today, I'm sure, on top of everything they got last night. So enjoy that.
Okay, I just found out that the internet is down completely. We are recording it, and we'll post it up later. If you're interested, you might tell some of your friends that have been watching on the internet. But hopefully, we're supposed to get Cox by the 11th. And hopefully, that'll take care of our problems. We've had a nightmare with our existing internet provider, but... this is a song that I hope that you'll love. Listen as Dara sings. I could never praise him enough.
I could never praise him enough for the cross of Calvary. I could never thank him enough for salvation full and free. I could never do anything to deserve such perfect love. Oh, for everything he's done, I could never praise him enough. For many years I've served the Lord the best that I know how, giving unto him my time and telling of his power. But if I were to spend unending hours on my knees, praising him for everything he's ever done for me, I could never praise him enough for the cross of Calvary. I could never thank him enough for salvation full and free. I could never do anything to deserve such perfect love. Oh, for everything he's done, I could never praise him enough. Thousand tongues could not express just what the Lord has done. As if he hadn't done enough, he sent his only son to hang upon a rugged cross and bear the load of sin. That explains why I can't express the love I have for him. I could never praise him enough for the cross of Calvary. I could never thank him enough for salvation full and free. I could never do anything to deserve such perfect love. Oh, for everything he's done, I could never praise him enough. So I'll sing, thank you, Lord, for
for saving my soul. Thank you, Lord, for making me whole.
I could never do anything to deserve such perfect love. Oh, for everything He's done. Never praise Him enough.
Miss Gail, where are you? Miss Gail Carter, would you come up? Gail's going to tell you about some missionaries in Kenya. And this story is so neat that I've decided we're going to use our Christmas offering to support these missionaries. But she's going to tell you about it, and it's got some things that, well, I'll let you just tell them.
Okay. Okay, so the first slide that's up there is a picture of Alan with the children, and I think that's, I can't see too good, Lee with the ladies, and then Ross with one of the babies. To get you started on it, Lee and Alan were called to Kenya many years ago. Their two oldest children were very small at the time, and they're both now grown with children of their own. So when their oldest daughter graduated high school, she came back to the United States for college, and she happened to have family in our area, so she ended up coming to our church, and that's how I got to know them. And then, of course, Lee and Alan visited, and they came to our church, and I've been trying to keep up with their missions ever since then, and they're just, to me, they are the feet and the heart of Jesus in Kenya. And they have three children. Abby's the oldest. She's in Texas now with her husband and two daughters. Her husband is a music minister. And so that's Lee and Alan's home base when they come back to the States. Their son Connor lives in West Virginia with his wife and two sons. So they've been there this past week visiting with them. And they're getting ready to go out to churches now and tell about their ministry and stuff. And this picture is, I think this is in front of their church building, and this is the people of the village. I didn't tell you about Ross either. Ross is their youngest son. They met Ross when he was an infant, and I think they sort of immediately fell in love with him and began trying to adopt him. So they worked hard for a few years and were finally officially able to adopt him, and he became part of the family too. And I think he is somewhere around 15 now, and he's just he's really special, and he's the heart of the family now. So let's go to, this is Alan working with the men. He does a Bible study with the men. He also works, there's a couple of the men in the village that are pastors, and he works with them, training them and helping them to learn to be pastors. The next one is Alan with the children. I think this is probably his most special ministry. He loves the children, and they love him. I've seen Lee post many times about how much the children just hang on to Alan when he's around, and they just listen to everything he says. The next picture is some of the homes in the village. So this is how the people live. The name of the village is Loangila, and it is a village. It's not near a town. So it's anything they need, like if they have to go into town for something, they get a lot at one time so they don't have to make so many trips. And then the next picture is their home. That is called an earth house. It's filled bags filled with dirt, and the people in the village helped them build this. There's three domes, and they stacked the bags up and then put concrete on the outside of them. And for the first few years that they lived in this house, they had dirt floors, and the walls on the inside were just the bags. There was nothing covering them. This past summer, they were actually able to put concrete on the floor, and they've put concrete partway up on the walls. So I know that helps with the dust and all. They have solar panels that they use to have what little electricity they have. They're down close to the ground, so they have to be cleaned regularly. And they run just a few things. They have a computer, they have a light, and they have a fan that they run at night. This village is in the desert. The temperatures they have are like we have here. There's no air conditioning. All they have is that one fan that they use at night so that they can sleep. There's a couple more ministries I want to tell you about that's not in this. They're fairly new. Lee has started a prayer walk that she walks around the village with some of the other ladies and pray. She actually put a video on YouTube that is part of her walk. You can see it's like a virtual prayer walk, and it has the prayer that scrolls up so you can read the prayer that she prays as they go through. And they've done two or three different versions. One of them is for the village, and one of them is for the leaders, and then asking for, you know, salvation for the people. So this is a really important ministry that she started. Another one that they've been doing, they've been making Bible story cloths, and they have translated the Bible into the language of the people of the village, and they have done audio Bibles and the prayer cloths, and they are giving them to each family. We'll get a set of it. I think she said they had done 40 some so far. So they're trying to make sure every member or every family in the village has a copy of that. And then the last project I want to tell you about is a really special project. They started, the ladies started a project of beading. They make jewelry. This is a necklace that I bought from them. I have the bracelet to go with it, but of course I laid it somewhere where I could find it this morning and didn't find it. These are some Christmas ornaments that they're making, little angels and wreaths, and they have all colors. They have different styles of jewelry, and the story behind this is really special. And I could never tell you the story as good as Lee tells it herself. So I'm just going to read this to you from her words. The title of it is Making Charcoal. When they leave in the morning to make charcoal, they tie the large piece of fabric around their stomachs. They tell me this keeps them from getting hungry. They walk 4 hours to get to where the trees are, and they spend about 4 hours cutting down trees with a machete. And then they walk 4 hours home. When they arrive home, they still have to cook a meal from scratch for their families. A few hours later, they lay down on their dirt floor, utterly exhausted. But tomorrow, they have to do it all again. The first 3 days, they cut down trees. The fourth day, they cut the trees into smaller pieces. The fifth day, they cover the wood with grass and mud and light the fire. Through small vent holes in the mud. They will go back the sixth day to check that the fire hasn't gone out. And then the seventh day, it should be ready. For this back-breaking week of work, they make less than $20. What choice do I have? One day I heard some ladies talking excitedly near my neighbor's house. When the pastor's wife passed by later, I asked her what was going on. She told me that she and some of the other ladies had been making charcoal, And they got caught by the forest ranger, and he chased them away. Cutting down the trees was illegal. The forest rangers were carrying an AK-47 while he was chasing them. Some of them fell along the way or dropped something important, but they all made it back to the village. One lady had broken her toe. The next day, the pastor's wife passed by again. When she was leaving, she told me she was going to check on her charcoal. I was stunned. I said, "Wait a minute. Didn't you just get chased yesterday by the forest ranger?" She said, "Yes," to which I replied, "And you're going back today?" And she replied, "What choice do I have?" That phrase has resonated in my mind often. What choice do I have? We believe God brought us the beating project to give these ladies another choice. So after the service today, I'm going to be over at the table over here and have a few pieces of what they've got so you can see. And if anybody wants to order any of the jewelry or the ornaments, I'll be glad to take up the order and get it ordered. Probably in about 2 weeks, because they will start running out of stuff. And I can give you the website where you can look to see what styles and what colors and all they have. So if you want anything, you can tell me next Sunday or the next Sunday, and then I'll get it ordered for you. And I know that they will really appreciate the help and the offering. And just know that you're really helping some really good people do God's work.
Thank you, Gail. I think this would be a great ministry for us to help with our Christmas offering. And from now until December 20th, if you would like to help just for missions, everything that goes with for missions and the offering, we will send to the Kenya missionaries, Adam and Lee. And so I hope that you'll help with that. And you may not be prepared to do it today, but ladies, if you'd like to get some of this jewelry, it'll be a blessing to their ministry. I invite you to take your Bibles, if you would, please, and turn with me to Romans chapter 11. We'll be looking there in just a moment.
whose wisdom is my perfect peace, whose every thought is love. For every day I have on earth is given by the King. So I will give my life, my all, to love and follow Him. To love and follow Him.
I apologize for being a little slow today. I'm just a little sore from the heart catheterization, but I'm happy to report to you that I didn't have any blockages. But I do meet with the surgeon tomorrow, and so I hope you'll pray about that. I am going to have surgery sometime, but just don't know when. But this will be the first time I've actually met with the cardiothoracic surgeon, and I'd appreciate your prayers about that. Romans chapter 11, and we're going to begin with verse 16. If you're able to stand, would you stand with us as we read? I'm just going to read verses 16 through 18 for now, but we're also going to look at some other verses down in the chapter a little bit. We've been talking for the last 4 weeks, even longer than that, about the rejection of the Jews to the Lord Jesus Christ and the gospel. Back in chapter 9 is when we started talking about this. So chapters 9, 10, and 11 deal with Israel's rejection of the Lord Jesus. And so we're looking at it again from a little different illustration that Paul uses. Notice, if you would, in verse 16. For if the first fruit is holy, the lump is also holy. And if the root is holy, so are the branches. And if some of the branches were broken off, and you, being a wild olive tree, were grafted in among them, and with them became partaker of the root and fatness of the olive tree, do not boast against the branches. But if you do boast, remember that you do not support the root, but the root supports you. Let's bow our heads for prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for the privilege of being in this place. Would you speak to our hearts as we consider this passage of Scripture? And Lord, I need your help today. And more than anything, I want you to speak to hearts. If there's someone here who does not know you as Savior, we pray that they'd come to know you even today. In Christ's name we pray, and for His sake, amen. Please be seated. We see in Romans 11 that God set aside the people, the Jews, because of their rejection of the Lord Jesus Christ in order for us Gentiles to be saved. And there are two groups within the nation of Israel spiritually. There are those who chose by the grace of God to remain faithful to the Lord and follow the Lord. But there are also those who rejected the Lord Jesus Christ and were judicially hardened by God and could not believe at one time. So the very blessings that God gave to the nation of Israel caused them to be in a spiritual stupor, so much so that the very blessings that God gave them became a trap or a snare for them. And so that did not mean that God has canceled His promises, and I'm grateful for that. Not at all. He keeps His promises, but He made it possible for those of us who are Gentiles to be able to receive the wonderful mercy and forgiveness of the Lord Jesus Christ by repentance and faith. And so Can Jewish people be saved? Absolutely they can. Of course they can. But it's not through the Old Testament sacrifices and the feast and the rituals. It's by grace, through faith, just like everybody else. Now, there are three things that I want you to notice in the passage. And by the way, just by way of review, we asked the question, first of all, has God cast away Israel? We talked about Israel's place and God's promise and Paul's proof. And the next slide, we talked about Israel's problem and predicament and paralysis and peril. Then, last time, we talked about Israel's fall. We talked about the fact that, next slide, if you would please, that there were three Old Testament examples of Gentiles becoming Jews. We talked about Ruth and Naomi, and then Naaman, the guy that dipped seven times because he had leprosy. And we also talked about, what was the last one? But go back up for me, Esther, about how many of the people in Assyria came to know the Lord as a result of that. So anyway, today we're going to look at three things. Go ahead and skip that and we'll get to the one we're talking about today. First of all, I want you to notice the offering bestowed. And he uses an Old Testament example here as an illustration. Look at verse 16 once again. For if the first fruit is holy, the lump is also holy. And if the root is holy, so are the branches. Now, you may not understand what that's talking about. Hopefully I'll explain it to you, but every Jew knew what Paul was talking about in this passage. You see, when God gave instructions that when they got into the land of Canaan, that the very first fruits of their crops were to be given to the Lord. That it was an offering that you give to the Lord. You know, some of you have told me before, the first thing you do when you get paid is you write your tithe check. Boy, it's a good practice to get in, you know. And we have that example from the Old Testament. The first fruits belong to the Lord. And that's what the passage is talking about. God gave Israel instructions of what they were to offer to God when they came into the land of Canaan. Now, these words were given to the people of Israel through Moses. Notice in Numbers 15 and verse 17, again, the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, speak to the children of Israel and say to them, when you come into the land to which I will bring you, then it will be when you eat the bread of the land that you shall offer up a heave offering to the Lord. You shall offer up a cake in the first of your ground meal as a heave offering on the threshing floor, so shall you offer up. Of the first fruit of your ground meal, you shall give it to the Lord, a heave offering throughout your generations. So this was a common practice among the Jews, and Paul knew that the Jewish believers in Rome knew what they would be talking about. Both the part and the whole had to possess the qualities of holiness. In other words, this first fruits, this first part was given to the Lord because it was holy. Notice in Leviticus 23:10, speak to the children of Israel and say to them, when you come into the land, which I will give you, and reap its harvest, you shall bring a sheaf of the first fruits of the harvest to the priest. So the Jews were to bring in an offering of their first fruit to the priest. And of course, that's how the priests were taken care of. You say, well, why is that necessary? Well, this is a picture of what was going to happen in the New Testament, because we are the kind of first fruits of the Lord's creations when we repent and when we believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. James 1:18 says, of his own will, he brought us forth the word of truth that we might be a kind of first fruits of his creatures. So when you and I come to faith in Christ, when we hear the gospel and we are convicted in our hearts and we repent of our sin and believe and trust the Lord Jesus Christ, he forgives us and we ourselves become that first fruits offering that they did in the Old Testament. That is a picture from the Old Testament of the reality of what happens in the New Testament when we repent and believe. Does that make sense? So, you got to understand this idea from the Old Testament. Now, the word holy has a special meaning. It means separated from the profane, from that which is profane and be useless, and consecrated to God. It doesn't mean that all Jews or all Israelis are holy. That's not what it's talking about. In fact, some of them were accursed and some of them were idolaters, but that's not what it's talking about. God chose them through whom the Messiah would come. And so through Israel, the Messiah came, and all who repent and believe in Jesus Christ become the first fruits of his creation. And so those cakes and those loaves that were given to the priest to help support them, they were given the responsibility of the temple or even the tabernacle in the wilderness wanderings and later in the temple. And therefore, any bread that was eaten by their household was a special portion of the priest. And the first piece of the dough off of their, when they went to make bread, they brought that to the priest, to the house of God, as an offering to the Lord. It was a special piece that represented the entire loaf, and that was acknowledged as being holy to the Lord. And that was the reason for that. Now, the second thing that I want you to notice is not only the offering bestowed, but notice the olive branches themselves. This section is one of the most difficult to understand. And I'll be honest with you, I read like 6 different commentaries about this, and I don't think any of them had it right. So this is gospel according to St. Howard. You take it the best you can, okay? But I even checked with Brother Dale about this, and so I want you to know that. So scholars disagree on how this passage is supposed to be interpreted. And I believe that part of the difficulty is how you look at this passage. And is Paul talking about individuals, or is he talking about a nation? My personal opinion is that he's talking about it. When he mentions Israel as a whole, he is talking about the nation of Israel, and he's talking about their rejection of God as a whole nation. But I believe when he talks about, even though the nation rejected, there was still a remnant that believed. And so I think he's talking about individuals, both Jew and Gentile in the passage. So, you know, is he referring to Jews and Gentiles collectively or individually, or is he referring to groups? Well, notice the analogy from the Old Testament. In Jeremiah chapter 11, verse 16, a unique term is used to speak of Israel. The Lord called your name, notice this, green olive tree, lovely and of good fruit. With the noise of the great tumult, he has kindled a fire on it, and its branches are broken. And by the way, we have olive trees around here. Most of the olive trees around here are Russian olives. And are any of you allergic to them? Okay, a couple of you are. I don't know, but they're green year-round, aren't they? And so he calls them a green olive tree. Now, that's the name he uses for the nation of Israel. It was a tree that had great fruit. They used not only the olives themselves, but they pressed the olives and made oil out of them and used them for a lot of different things. However, God judged Israel because of their idolatry. When they turned away from God to serve false gods, God judged them for it, and their judgment was a kindled fire on it. Not only that, but notice that passage says that the branches are broken off. Now, in John chapter 15 and verse 2, Jesus says this, "Every branch in me," look at it, "that does not bear fruit," what does he do? He takes it away. "And every branch that bears fruit, he prunes, that it may bring more fruit." Any of you raised tomatoes ever? Okay, some of you know. That little sprout that comes out between the branches on tomatoes, what do you call those? Suckers. Why? Because they don't produce any fruit and they draw life away from the main branch. So what do? You pop those off of there. Why? So the growth and the nutrients and the energy can go to the branches that are going to produce the tomatoes. Amen? And don't you wish we had some from Oklahoma right now? But anyway, but they are better in Oklahoma than they are out here. But I just want you to know that. But I believe part of the problem when understanding this passage of the Bible is that Bible students only see how God dealt with a nation, and not how he deals with individuals. Because of their rejection of God and their disobedience, God broke off the branches, the Israeli branches, the Jewish branches. He broke them off in judgment. Do you understand that? Because of their rejection, God broke them off. Now, they were a chosen people, a holy nation. That's all true. But because of their rejection of God's plan and their idolatry, these branches were broken off of the trunk or the vine and replaced by new graftings. I got to preach in Selma, California. Anybody of you know what Selma, California is famous for? That's where Sun-Made Raisins are from. In Selma, California. So there are vineyards everywhere. But we stayed in a place that I looked out and they had these trees out there. And they looked like plum trees, but they weren't. And I asked what they are and they said, those are pluots. Or they're also called plumcots. You have a root or the trunk that comes out and is either apricot or plum, and then they graft in a plum or apricot to that, and what comes out of that is called pluots or plumcots, and they're really good. You ought to try some, okay? But I'd never heard of that. They were grafted in. Now, I don't know much about grafting. But what I do know about grafting, I believe, is important here. I believe the root that we're talking about in the passage is not Israel. It's the Lord Jesus. Because that's where life comes from. It's the Lord Jesus Christ. And the branches that were broken off were the Jewish people who refused to believe. Dr. John MacArthur, who's the pastor of Grace Community Church, wrote this about this passage. It did not take long for early Gentiles to be tempted to scorn the Jews because they had scorned Christ. The notion poured fuel on the fire of anti-Semitism that existed in many Gentile nations and cultures for countless centuries. It is seen in the scripture in the enmity between Israel and her surrounding neighbors, such as Syria, Phoenicia, Moab, Edom, the Philistines, and other Canaanite peoples. It is seen in Israel's conquest and domination by Babylon, Assyria, Greece, and then Rome. And because many Gentile believers in the early church had been raised in the midst of pagan anti-Semitism, it was not difficult for Satan to tempt them to continued prejudice against the Jews because of Israel's rejection and crucifixion of her own Messiah and Savior, end quote. Now, here's the point of the passage. There's prejudice a long time from Old Testament times, even through the early part of our nation's history. Now, we've seen it recently in the race riots that have gone on in our country in some of our major cities. And I want to tell you right now, any kind of racial prejudice is sin. I don't care who it is. Well, I don't care who is against. It is a sin against God. Why? Because there is one race. And that's the human race. And we're all a part of it. Now, there's some people that I wonder about. But we're a part of the human race. And because of that, we are all part of God's creation. And it's not right for anyone to look down. Listen, as bad and as wicked a thing as what happened in Germany in the late 30s and through the 1945 with World War II and the absolute destruction and devastation of 6 million Jews being murdered by the Nazis. Even the Nazis, Jesus died for them. Even the rejecting Jews, Jesus Christ died for them. So, I believe the branches that are broken off are the Israelites who refused, or the Jewish people who refused and rejected Jesus Christ through unbelief. The whole world fell into sin in Adam. And the Bible says, wherefore, as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin, so death passed upon who? All men, for that all have sinned. And that's important for us to know. So in Adam, men died spiritually through that disobedience, but that did not thwart God's plan. God's plan was still to redeem men who would repent and believe. Notice what Isaiah says about God's choice of Abraham in Isaiah 51 and verse 1. Listen to me, you who follow after righteousness, you who seek the Lord, look to the rock from which you were hewn, and to the hole of the pit from which you were dug. Look to Abraham, your father, and to Sarah, who bore you. For I called him alone and blessed him and increased him. In other words, the King James says, look to Abraham, your father, and Sarah that bore you. For when he was but one, I called him, I blessed him, and made him many. God keeps his promises. Now, when you refuse to believe, those promises are conditional. When you reject what God's offered and you refuse to believe, you don't get saved automatically. That is the issue. Many came out of Abraham who were set apart for God. However, most of them rebelled against God, but that did not make void God's promise, because anybody, Jew or Gentile, who will repent and believe can be saved. And even though many of the children of Abraham committed great evil against the Lord and sinned against God through their idolatry and their rejection, the Messiah still came through Israel. Through that little Virgin Mary, Jesus came and was born, and we're about to celebrate the birth of our Lord Jesus Christ in just a few weeks. And we remember that he came as God had promised. But the breaking off has brought blessing to the whole world. Because of the breaking off of the branches of Israel, Jew and Gentile alike can be saved. So the apostle continues the argument. Some of the natural branches of the covenant tree were broken off, and in their place, God has grafted the rest of us. You know what he calls us? Shoots from a wild olive tree. Some of you all pretty wild, weren't you, before you got saved? Huh? Yeah. Some of us were pretty wild, but listen, aren't you grateful that God can graft us in? Romans 11, 17, for if some of the branches were broken off, and you being a wild olive tree were grafted in among them, and with them became partaker of the root and fatness of the olive tree. In other words, that's the blessing of the olive tree. The Jewish branches were broken off because of unbelief, and the Gentiles being wild olive trees were grafted in. They became partakers of the root and the fatness. Now, I don't know a lot about grafting, but what I've read about grafting is it's one of the most interesting processes in all of horticulture. Many plants are useless unless they are grafted into a root. I think the other word is called a scion, is another term that is used about that. And on their own, they're nothing. But when they're grafted into the rootstock, they become so close together that even through a microscope, you can't tell where the rootstock begins and where the graft begins. That is an amazing thing to me. You see, we are one in the Lord Jesus Christ. I am the vine, Jesus said. We are the branches. He that abides in me will bear much fruit. And that's great. Because of this phrase, this grafting has been practiced for centuries. And there have been a lot of things given and information given about this. The best authorities don't have the answer as to why that internet and that interwoven part of the cells of the graft and the root come together. They don't know how that happens. It is an amazing thing. But the Bible teaches us that all life comes from Jesus Christ. If you're in Jesus Christ, you have life. If you're not, you are dead in your trespasses and in sin, and there is nothing you can do. Your good works will not make you righteous before God. There is no life apart from the Lord Jesus. And so what we saw back in Romans chapter 6 is that Jesus offers life to both Jews and Gentiles. The Adam, who was the first Adam and was the head of the human race, because he sinned, we all have that sin nature passed on to us. But the second Adam, the Lord Jesus Christ, the one who died on the cross, was buried, and rose again, he offers life to all. Galatians 3:16 says, "Now to Abraham and his seed were the promises made." He does not say, "And to seeds as of many, but as of one, and to your seed, who is Christ." It is not the blessing that God gives to Israel. It's the blessing God gave to us through the Lord Jesus Christ. Does that make sense? Not to seeds many, but seeds of one. The promise of mercy and grace and forgiveness is available to everyone, both Jew and Gentile, who will repent and trust Jesus. Now, let's look at the final thing. The only boasting. The offering bestowed and the olive branches. But the only boasting is in verse 18. Notice, "Do not boast against the branches. But if you do boast, remember that you do not support the root, but the root supports you." You see, in the Old Testament, there are two prophecies concerning the olive tree, and both of them refer to Israel. The first one is the one we read just a few moments ago back in Jeremiah 11. But let me read the second one to you from Hosea chapter 14 and verse 5. "I will be like the dew to Israel. He shall grow like the lily and lengthen his roots like Lebanon. His branches shall spread. His beauty shall be like an olive tree and his fragrance like Lebanon. Those who dwell under his shadow shall return. They shall be revived like grain and grow like a vine. Their scent shall be like the wine of Lebanon. Ephraim shall say, 'What have I to do anymore with idols? I have heard and observed him. I am like a green cypress tree. Your fruit is found in me. Who is wise? Let him understand these things. Who is prudent? Let him know them. For the ways of the Lord are right. The righteous walk in them, but transgressors stumble in them." Today, most Jewish people are broken branches. They are broken branches. But God has grafted in a whole bunch of us Gentiles. And that's a great thing for all of us. But as Gentiles, let's not make the mistake of presuming on the grace of God, just like Israel did in her Old Testament days of idolatry and in their days in the New Testament of their rejection of the Lord Jesus Christ. God offers blessings to those who will believe and obey. And that's important. Belief behaves. That's important for us to know. God offers his blessings through Jesus Christ to every son of Abraham and to Gentiles whom God grafts in the vines. But he calls for us to be humbled and grateful for God's blessings. I want you to notice, if you would, verses 19 through 24. We did not read these earlier, but I want you to notice them as I close today. Look in verse 19. "You will say then, 'Branches were broken off that I might be grafted in.' Well said, because of unbelief, they were broken off, and you stand by faith." Now let me ask you, if we were grafted in as Gentiles, the Jews were broken off by what? Unbelief. So in order to be grafted in, you have to believe. Amen? And that's important for you to know. Now notice what it says. "Because of their unbelief, they were broken off, and you stand by faith. Don't be haughty." What is it? "Hey, look at me. I'm a Gentile. I'm grafted in." No. Don't be like that. "But fear." Look at the next phrase. "For if God..." Look at this. "For if God did not spare the natural branches, he may not spare you either. Therefore, consider the goodness and the severity of God." People say, well, you Free Will Baptists believe you can lose your salvation. No, you lose your car keys or your checkbook. You forfeit salvation through unbelief. That's a big difference. Notice this. Therefore, consider the goodness and severity of God. On those who fail, severity. But toward you, goodness, if you continue in His goodness, otherwise, you also will be cut off. That's a warning. And they also, if they do not continue in unbelief, will be grafted in. That means that's good news for the Jews. If they will come to believe, they can be grafted in. For God is able to graft them in again. Praise God for that. For if you were cut out of the olive tree, which is wild by nature, and were grafted contrary to nature into the cultivated olive tree, look at this. How much more will these who are natural branches be grafted into their own olive tree? That is a great passage of scripture to me. I don't think it means at all that Israel is getting a pass on anything. I think what it shows is the grace of mercy and mercy of God to everybody, both Jew and Gentile. We're not to be haughty as Gentiles and be proud who've been grafted in, but rather, if God did not spare the natural branches, in other words, Israel, because of their rejection and unbelief, He's not going to spare you if you walk away in unbelief. I believe we've got to understand God's plan. His sovereign goodness selected Israel as His chosen people to bring the Savior into the world. And I'm glad about that. I'm glad about all the Old Testament prophecies. Over 300 prophecies just relating to Jesus Christ were fulfilled when Jesus was born. I mean, to the very letter, He fulfilled it as God planned. But as Gentile believers, we're to pray for the peace of Israel. Hey, listen, it is important. I don't know if you realize this or not, but what has happened with the UAE and Syria and some of those countries there in the Middle East is earth-shattering. It really is. And you say, well, Pastor, is it setting up for the second coming of Jesus? Listen, Jesus could come today. He could come today. And I hope He comes before November 3rd, don't you? But anyway, in true Christianity, there is no room for boasting. The only boast is in Jesus Christ. Yeah. Yeah. And Thanksgiving, this month is all about that. Our thanks and our praise ought to be to Him. Yeah. I want to thank you personally for what you all did for all of us, four preachers, last week. And I can't thank you enough for what you did. But you know, the gratefulness of my heart is not just for you. It's to God for giving you to me to be your shepherd, your pastor. And you, God has been gracious to me. I wouldn't trade you for any congregation. Listen, with all of our warts and all of our misgivings, I wouldn't trade you for anybody. I'm not looking for any place to go. I don't want any other church. There's not a church in the world that I want. I'm glad God's called me here. And if I can come back and after this surgery and be your pastor, then, you know, I want to do it till I'm 100. But I don't know what's going to happen. But I believe God, I believe we can trust Him and we can praise Him no matter what. You say, but Pastor, this is serious surgery you're having, isn't it? Yes, it is. Patsy doesn't like to think about it, but I watched on the internet what they do. Their stuff they get at Home Depot, that's, I mean, it's wire mesh stuff, and depending on where the aneurysm is, they've got this device that looks like a piece of pipe from Home Depot that they put inside you. You say, is that what you're going to have? As far as I know, I meet tomorrow, find out. Say, when's it going to be? I don't know. I just hope he uses some knife that's not been rested or something, you know. So, but Pastor, what if you die on the operating table? This is his church. And God will take care of his church. And if he calls me home, I'm ready to go. And I don't want you coming by my casket and saying, oh, he looks so natural. If you come by, oh, you say, what do you want people to say? I want them to say, oh, look, he's moving. You know, and so. Amen. You see, Gentile believers being grafted into the vine of Jesus Christ is all God's doing. We have nothing to boast about. Nothing whatsoever. God keeps his promises. And remember, it is not we who support the vine, but the vine who supports us. If you don't know the vine, his name is Jesus. And you could come to him today if you want to. And we've got a place for you to pray. If you're not sure if you died today, you'd go to heaven. If you were facing surgery, like I say, boy, listen, I wouldn't go into surgery unless I knew things was right with God. If you're not sure of that, I want you to make sure today. You can come here. We have some folks that will pray with you, and you can settle that between you and God today if you want to. Would you stand with me for prayer with our heads bowed and eyes closed? Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. And I thank you for the opportunity we have to hear it and to enjoy fellowship and to sing praises to your name. Lord, we are grateful for what you've done. And as Gentiles, those of us who have been grafted in, Lord, we can't thank you enough. Help us to remain true and faithful to you. If there is one here today that does not know you, I pray that they would come to know you even now. In Jesus' name, our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed. Some of you are not sure about your relationship with the Lord. You've raised your hands recently in a service, expressing to me that you're not certain about your relationship with Jesus Christ. I want to encourage you right where you stand. If you will say, Lord Jesus, I know I have broken your law. I know that I deserve the death penalty. Will you forgive me of my sin? I do now repent of my law breaking and ask you to save me. He will do that right now where you stand. While heads are bowed and eyes are closed, if you are praying that prayer right now, just by uplifting your hand, just shoulder high and put it right back down, I'm praying that prayer, Pastor. God bless you. Anybody else? I'm praying that prayer. I'm asking the Lord Jesus to forgive me. God bless you. Anyone else? God bless each of you. I want to encourage you to make that decision a public one. The Bible says in Matthew chapter 10, whoever will confess me before men, him will I also confess before my Father which is in heaven. But whoever denies me before men, him will I also deny before my Father which is in heaven. I'm glad you're praying that prayer now. I want to give you an opportunity to make that a public decision now. While Mike sings one verse of him, would you come and meet us here and let's make that decision a public one today?
Pass me not, O gentle Savior, hear my humble cry. While on others thou art calling, do not pass me by.
You may be seated for just a moment. If you have questions about Christ Church or if we can be of assistance to you, you can check us out at ccfwb.org or you can call here to the church at 480-435-1681. I think that's wrong. 1668, isn't it? Or 1668. So anyway, that number is wrong. I apologize for that. We'll try to get that fixed for next time. But anyway, there is a little piece of video from Dr. Dobson that we want you to take a look at. The election, how many of you are going to go to the polls to vote on November the 3rd? Okay, hopefully this piece of little video will help you and encourage you as you go to vote. Go ahead and play that for us if you would. You have to turn 15 and 16 on. Maybe it's not on the video. It's not going to work.
It's only going to play that first minute. It's got loaded anyways.
Oh. I got you. Okay. All right. Perhaps if you're interested in the link. Okay. We'll send it on SK Notify to those of you that are on SK Notify and you can watch it. Dr. James Dobson has some important words about this election. And anyway. Okay. Sorry. Pastor Matt.
I spent over an hour on the phone this week with our internet provider, and it's just been a headache, but hopefully we're looking at some light at the end of the tunnel with that coming up. But Tuesday's a big day in a lot of ways, but, you know, Republicans and Democrats, both of them, most of what they promote does not line up with this book, okay? You know, how they want to spend money, how they want to teach kids, how they want to treat old people. Most of it is against God's word. But on a few things we've got guides there on the table for a few things that this, you know, one side's with God's word on this issue, one side's against. But anyways, it's not, you know, we give people our vote. We don't give them our heart. There's a difference. There's a difference with that, thing. So, but do pray for our country. Pray for healing, for unity, for peace. We do have the offering box over there. We're still not passing the offering plate yet, but we have the offering box if you want to give in person. You can give worship through giving through our website, through text to giving. And over by the offering box is the sign-up list for the Family Lord's Supper. That's the Sunday and the Monday right before Thanksgiving. So it's a special thing that we do here at church if you want to go ahead and sign up for a time with that. Let's all stand as we close in prayer. Dear Lord, we thank you for today. We thank you for the chance that we have to come and meet and to continue to learn about your word. We thank you for the good report for Pastor Howard's test this week. And we just ask that you would give your hand of healing and give wisdom for the surgery coming up. We know this is your church and that you will provide and everything that we need. We thank you for your truth in this passage of how the gospel is not just for the people of Israel, but that you allowed the wild branches of even people here in the United States of America, even in Arizona, that we can come and believe and understand the gospel. And we thank you for that. We thank you that the gospel is open to everyone. We ask that you would be with our country this week. May there be peace. We know there's potential for violence and for other things out there possibly this week. But Lord, we just ask that there could be healing, there could be unity, and that your will would be done. And we pray for our nation and we pray for the future. But we know ultimately that you are still on the throne through everything. We ask that you give us wisdom as we go into the next few weeks with our classes and our Bible studies and this time of Thanksgiving. May we look to you especially and be with us as we go our separate ways. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.